Good to go? Okay, here we go. As per last week, I wanted to start with an example. Just a little bit of reflection on your part. Of times that you've experienced anxiety in your life, and none of us are bulletproof, so the chances are we've had this feeling at some point. It could have been a big sporting event, it could have been before a presentation, or an exam in particular. And if, let's try and be honest with ourselves. Again, I won't ask you to say it out loud because, you know, no one ever puts their hand up for these things. But obvious symptoms, bodily symptoms, clammy sweaty palms, increased heart rate. Very often, when we're stressed, for some reason, our breathing, rather than becoming deep and filling our lungs full of oxygen, our breathing becomes shallow and we just take short, sharp breaths. And I noticed that in, this is a weird quirk, but in horror films, when they're trying to make you feel nervous, they do the boom, 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 and they make the breathing sound short and sharp, and it just makes you feel nervous as well. What else? Okay, the one that everyone's afraid to say, obviously, you need to go to the toilet more often. It's obvious, and there's an evolutionary reason for that. At one point in our history, it was very good to dump anything spare and then run a bit quicker. We don't need that anymore, and yet it's still part of our, stress response system. And that's just the bodily symptoms. What about the mental symptoms? The chances are it's very hard to stay focused. The consequences of failing become very prominent in your mind. Multiple thoughts go through your mind, and you're unable to stay fixed on one for a length of time. They all seem important, they all seem urgent. And the way I characterise it is that the very way that you would think to perform well, which is normally effortless, uncontrolled, fluid, the exact opposite of how you feel when anxiety really kicks in. So you can see a really obvious argument that those things, and I've also missed out the another obvious one, muscle tension. When people are anxious, they tend to exhibit slightly increased muscle tone in key muscle groups. So, for example, across the back or in their hamstring, which is why people who are nervous often pull their hamstrings. There's a huge issue with that because it means that when you go to perform a movement, to run, all the muscles in your body, almost all of them, are in antagonistic pairs. Bicep, tricep, pull against each other. Legs pull against each other, the two muscles. If one of those muscles is already tense because you're anxious, you're pulling against a tense force. It makes life much harder for you. That's where the phrase running through treacle might have come to pass. So all these things are very adverse for performing well. You want to perform well, you don't want any of those things happening. You want to be, the idea is, relaxed, fluid, loose, thinking clearly. The exact opposite. So, what I want to do is walk you through how we studied that so far, starting with this huge problem in the literature, which you might see yourself, where we just have clumped together stress, anxiety, and arousal. And you just go, it's probably the same thing. And yet, realistically, we can differentiate between them. So I'm going to spend the first half of the lecture showing you the difference between those. Then I'm going to outline to you the ways we go about trying to reduce stress or anxiety, at least to a reasonable level, or to manage arousal. And I'm going to show you some of the evidence which has been used to discuss whether they're good or bad and whether it works. And I reckon that'll fill the hour quite easily. And as I said, for most of these, my plan is to do it for roughly an hour. If I overrun, that's fine, but it's getting late in the day to do a full 2 hour talk. Start with definitions, the same way you'll start with definitions. Stress is a response to the specific perception, this has always been the definition, that the demands being placed upon you are greater than your ability to cope, your resources. There's a couple of key parts of that definition which are key. First of all, it's a perception. So it might well be the case that you're wrong in your appraisal and actually you could have coped perfectly well. Or that the demands being placed upon you are not that bad. And if you perceive that they're big or you perceive that you can't cope, that's trouble. That stimulates the stress response. Following on from last time as well, some people add to the definition that you have to believe that it has negative consequences for you if you fail. So it's too much for me to do on my own, I can't cope with that, and if I fail, I'm in trouble. And in some definitions, if you haven't got that addition at the end, it's not real stress. Which is what I've put there. Always getting ahead of myself, you've noticed that's a thing I do, obviously. And this is just talking about stress, just going back to classic literature, 1970, 1978. Fairly classic stuff where people have just first tried to get a grip on what this phenomenon is, what this concept is. At the other end of the spectrum entirely from this stress response is arousal. Now, arousal is very, very basic. Stress involves this perception and this evaluation on your part at a cognitive level. I believe this is a big demand, I evaluate that I can't cope with that and that it's negative. Lots of thinking going on in the stress situation. In contrast, arousal is believed to be very physiological. So if I wanted to increase my arousal, I'd run up those stairs, come back down and my heart would be pumping, I'd be out of breath, so I'd become apparently more aroused. There's an energizing function. And you can track that, you can see how cortisol or certain hormones would have been released in certain, you know, physical exertions like that. We've fudged around over the history with arousal. We've mixed it in with anxiety, willy-nilly. We've just gone from high to low in some theories, very aroused, under-aroused, and that misses out important aspects of what arousal is. We need to be very specific in saying it's something. I've got a picture coming up shortly, but if you imagine an axis from very, very cognitive and brain-involving down to very, very bodily and physiological, arousal has to be at the physiological end of the spectrum. Very physical, very short-lived, very little cognitive involvement. And if you can define it that way, you make your life a lot easier writing about it. So in theory, arousal could vary from deep sleep right the way up to a kind of frenetic frenzy. Maybe after too many Red Bulls or something like that. Sitting in between those, if we try and keep ourselves defining things neatly and clearly to keep ourselves sane, sitting in between those is anxiety. And even anxiety, you'll see shortly, split down into subsections. But it's a negative emotional state with feelings of nervousness, worry, apprehension, and activation of the body. And we can just about tease out the physical and the emotional side. But it's something you're conscious of. So when it comes to small differences or even modest differences in arousal between being fairly awake and alert and fairly sleepy and tired, and you're sat on your sofa at night, sometimes you won't bother to know the difference. It's not something that's on your mind whether you're awake or tired. Whereas anxiety is on your mind, it gets its way into your awareness more often than not. In fact, the way we measure it, mainly using questionnaires, means it has to be on your mind, otherwise you couldn't tick the response. So it has to be something which is going through your cognitive appraisal system on some level. Other than saying thing, I think not, but I promise you when you read about this, you will see them used synonymously. And of course, watching sport, you'll hear them used by commentators in the same breath to mean the same thing. But to keep ourselves sane, it's helpful to differentiate. So this is not from a textbook, it's not to be referenced, but it is something which I think helps us to think about it. Arousal sits at a bodily level, doesn't last very long, and has no cognitive component. You don't think about arousal. Stress at the other end of the spectrum involves a huge amount of cognitive appraisal. It can be wrong, don't forget, you can get your appraisal wrong, but there's a lot of thinking involved in the demand being placed on me, my ability to cope, the consequences of failing. Lots of evaluation going on. And it generally lasts a long time. So one of the best measures of stress that we have, which I'll show you shortly, measures over the last year. So stress in that conceptualization lasts a long time. Sitting in between that is this kind of in-between anxiety. Yes, there's some cognitive anxiety because it's called cognitive anxiety. That can last varying amounts of time. So it's not this kind of build-up like stress, but you can think negative thoughts and it's possible to stop that and switch. Therefore, it's quite a quick change. And the somatic anxiety is the symptoms I described in the body, sweaty palms, heartbeat, breathing. And that, of course, is also quite brief. Being critical, which I like to do and I want you to do, when it came to differentiating between somatic anxiety and arousal, it's very difficult. The only difference that I can think of on the cuff is that, in theory, you're aware of somatic anxiety, you're much less aware of arousal. If you think about how we measure arousal, it's the same as all the stuff they do for the truth or lie test. You know, they'll measure for how well your skin conducts the current. They'll measure the dilation of your pupils. These are all things which you can't consciously control. Whereas, and you're not even aware of those things, whereas you are quite aware of clammy palms, heart rate, uncomfortable feelings, etc. Again, this is all in theory, and we could probably pull it apart a little bit. Focusing on that middle section of anxiety, another, not forgetting, psychologists love questionnaires. We like to say, well, maybe we could look at someone's general tendency to get anxious and make predictions off that. So if someone has a personality which tends to get anxious, then we could say that's trait anxiety, and they've got an anxious personality, and whatever happens, they're very prone to becoming anxious. And that's great, we love our questionnaires, we can correlate that with stuff, and we can go, oh well, anxious people tend to perform worse, anxious people tend to get injured more often, whatever it might be. If you have it measured as a personality stable trait, it's really convenient to do that. We all know though, even from the personality literature, that people change substantially from situation to situation. So it might not be that helpful to look at their general personality, it might be more helpful to say, in the here and now, how do you feel? And then look at whether you're likely to perform well, get injured, whatever it might be. As you know from last time, the problem with that is, and this keeps coming up, just by asking them, you ruin it. You're about to go and play your sport, you're in the middle of playing your sport, or doing something really excellent performance-wise, like brain surgery or something, a really pinnacle of your performance. How are you feeling? Nervous? Great, you feel better now then, dear. It's going to ruin it. Making them conscious changes the very nature of what they're experiencing. Most of this diagram that I've got on the board for you has come from the Weinberg-Gould textbook. You can tell by the slightly greeny colour scheme. You'll notice that at the bottom, there's a little addition that I've made just to try and distinguish between, it might be that a person is prone to become cognitively anxious, they might have a ruminating thinking tendency, which some people often have, where they just, the second something happens that's interesting, their brain fixates on it and replays it and goes over it and over it. So it might be that is a personality trait, or that a person tends to have an emotional physical reaction separately from the thinking reaction in relation to anything vaguely stressful, and that could be a personality trait. And at the individual momentary level, of course, you can have those responses as well. Measurement-wise, as a result, stretching from very physical up to very, very cognitive should reflect that. Should. See, how do I measure arousal? Well, I've already mentioned we can look at your heart rate, skin conductance, pupil dilation, things like that. Maybe even do a blood sample and get cortisol, adrenaline, all that sort of thing. Somatic anxiety, not that different, but in principle, you're aware of it, so a questionnaire might do the trick. Cognitive anxiety? Yeah, the questionnaires love it. Stress? Questionnaires as well. Recurring theme, perhaps. And not forgetting that if we think about that stress questionnaire, for example, it looks at important life events over the past year. People forget stuff, especially stressful things. We just sort of don't want to think about that. So there are obvious measurement problems going on here, but I must say that the Holmes Rate Scale we're about to review shortly is an excellent predictor of people becoming ill or getting injured, which is exactly what stress theoretically should lead to. So maybe it's doing quite a good job. This is one of the extra slides that I've inserted just before the lecture, realising that I've left it out. My apologies. This is a model of how we can think about arousal, or in particular, if we think about it as being affect. They're very similar concepts. Arousal is very physical. Affective state, with an A, are measured at that level, that physiological level. So it could be that we're talking about something very, very similar between arousal and affect. Now, if that were to be a fair comparison, then we end up with a distinction that goes two ways. It's called the circumflex model. Russell, obviously, was first off as a Greek guy by the name of Echicarchus. You'll see in a second. He's used it a lot, and it, again, it seems to predict useful things. You can stretch up or down the screen, high activation, low activation. And that sounds like the difference between the deep, deep sleep versus the too much Red Bull distinction. Fair enough. But then also, there's the appraisal of whether that's nice or nasty, going across the screen. So if you're highly, highly activated, and that's deemed to be unpleasant, then you might say that you're tense. Really, really anxious, flitty, whatever the word might be. And we're talking about this at a physiological level. If you are really, really activated in a positive way, you deemed it to be positive, then we could call that energetic. Buzzing, I feel great, that kind of idea. If you were really, really deactivated and you deemed that to be unpleasant, then we'd call that something like boredom, or maybe overtired. So tired, it actually hurts, that kind of feeling, which I hope you never get, but it can happen. Very deactivated in a negative way versus being very, very deactivated in a positive way. I've done a really good day's work there, I'm really tired, I'm pleased with myself, that feels good. Good spot, that's a typo, my mistake. Very good spot. So that bottom right hand corner should be unactivated, pleasant. And there you go, my voice on the tape saying it, so you can't go wrong. So just to show how this can be used, because it's so simple, you can get people, when they're doing cycling, swimming, running, whatever, to point to it. So you can hold it up and go, how are you feeling now? Oh, I don't know, death. And of course, one person running might be a bit inaccurate. But if you average it out across a bunch of people, you end up seeing patterns. So in this study, we saw a pattern where during a, I think it was a running protocol, it was really heavily used when they were testing out Lucozade and whether it works or not. So it was one of these things I really liked to try. So let's say before the person started running, they felt pretty neutral activation, deactivation, and fairly positive, but only slightly. And then as they ran, they became, yes, that was right, they became more and more activated, more aroused, and that was fairly positive. It was only a short 20 minutes, is that right? Very short run. And then as they calmed down 10 minutes later, their whole body system had started to cool back down again, and they were calmer, and their heart rate had gone down, so they moved back down that direction. And you can track this sort of thing over the long term, over the short term. One of the main things you can do is track it when people are exercising to exhaustion, just like the RPE scale. But just as they're getting to the point where it becomes exhausted, you can see the whole judgment of whether it's nice or nasty changes completely, which is quite interesting. So just an example of how it gets used. Again, thinking critically for a second, that is asking someone to think about and become aware of something which they probably shouldn't be able to access easily. So
So it's a little bit of a trick, a little bit naughty, but it does seem to work. And that's the nature of the beast, because on that axis from highly physical through to highly mental, there is blurry edges. There aren't nice clean divides. And it's up to us to try and maintain some kind of separation and order just to keep ourselves fairly focused and fairly sane. Because the biggest problem you experience in this area is very often being tempted off into look at other stuff, or that seems interesting, that seems interesting. Before you know it, you've gone through loads of work, loads of words, and achieved nothing. So the trick is to keep yourself reasonably focused. From the very, very physical through to the very, very mental stress. This is a very famous measurement technique. In the past year, how many of these things have you experienced? Some of them happen every year, Christmas, for example. Okay. Some of them are actually meant to be nice things. Getting a new job, having a vacation. And yet, they're down on here as things which count as causing stress, because they're sometimes quite big changes to negotiate. And this is where the idea comes from that divorce is one of the most stressful things that you can go through. Or the death of a family member, because it was all done in this scale back in 1967, a long time ago. But really interestingly, people who score high on this scale because they've had a busy last couple, even marriage, look, that's a positive one, just jumped out at me. That's meant to be a good thing, right? And yet it scores you quite a lot of points on the stress scale. The more things you've done in the past year which score you points, the higher your score, the more likely you are to become ill. More likely you are to have an accident or inattention. Because one of the things that stress does, really annoyingly, is narrows your visual field and you lose your peripheral vision. And I can vouch for that because when I was moving house once, which is quite a stressful thing on the list, I was loading up a van and walked straight into the door, cut my head wide open. How did I not see that? I put it there. But it's just you lose your peripheral vision when you're under stress.
And you can test that. You can get the computer game out and have dots come up on the screen, and people who are stressed score high on this will see the middle of the screen and just miss the edges completely. For me, that's vaguely interesting stuff, but that's a better way of measuring stress, because it's long term, it involves that appraisal, it fits the bill of what we're trying to measure. Right.
Measuring anxiety, if and when you come to read about this, you will see numerous questionnaires. We love questionnaires in psychology. One of the favourites is called the Cognitive State Anxiety Inventory, and especially the version 2. And you just tend to sort of measure things like how I feel right now in terms of thinking negative thoughts, or I'm experiencing these physical symptoms. And the scores on that will predict whatever we want to predict. Or they might even be predicted by someone's trait confidence or coping skills, or whatever it might be. There's the State Trait Anxiety Inventory, STAI. Again, that splits it, rather than cognitive somatic, it splits it into state versus trait. There's even more actually out there, and they all, as I said last time, they tend to be attached to their respective theory. So I'm going to show you the theories and just debate them a little bit. And you should know that for most of these, especially the ones that are still working, still alive, they have their own attached questionnaire. And that's always a weird thing, because if a theory tells you exactly what to measure and how to measure it, that should raise alarm bells, because you could ask, well, what's it missing? What am I being told not to measure by this theory? Surely that's important too.
Four big theories: drive theory, inverted U, eyes off. Missing from here is multidimensional anxiety, which I've got in the slides, and then catastrophe theory. Way back in the beginning, 1943, this should look familiar, right? It comes up, especially this and confidence have the same pattern of history. Straight line and motivation. Straight line, inverted U, and then we got more complex. So in the beginning, we would say, yes, you need to be more aroused to perform well. Forgetting, of course, that sports like darts and snooker, and like I said, brain surgery or
maybe even flying a plane, things which involve high-level performance, perhaps, don't require you to be that aroused. But the idea is, and it was actually sort of clubbed together into some kind of drive construct. That's what they called it. Ah, drive. If you're highly aroused, you have more drive, and that's good. The more of it, the better. Really obviously that falls apart, because we know that there's a point where you can become too aroused, too anxious, or whatever the word might be, and it can go against you. So that didn't last very long at all. The inverted U is the one which, again, sticks with people. The Goldilocks effect. Too little, too much, just right. But it doesn't break down into stress, two types of anxiety, arousal, it just clumps them together again. So there we go, okay. And even this one being quite specific, physiological arousal, it's not actually that helpful in terms of different personalities, different sports, different tasks within those sports. It becomes a very blunt instrument just to talk in general in the pub, but not actually to help scientists or athletes study it. But it is extremely popular because of its intuitive appeal. To solve that problem of not matching the sport or task and the athlete's individual personality, Yuri Hanin, who has had a fantastic career and done a lot of work, back in 1980, suggested individualized zones for optimal functioning, which I still struggle to say coherently, but eyes off. So he would say, okay, there's a level that's too low, a level that's too high, and a just right level, and he would call it a bandwidth. And it depends on the person and the sport. So this person in this sport, this is their zone of optimal functioning. So it's just a way of taking the inverted U and making it more personalized and more specific. It was a creative attempt to solve the problem, but it still has the problem of smudging together all the different concepts, anxiety, arousal, stress. Smudges them all together. And actually, this is another important aspect of it. It doesn't say why there's this link between anxiety or arousal and performance. It just describes the shape of the curve for that person. So the idea would be that, for one athlete, they've got a perfect zone that's very low arousal. Somebody else, it might be in the middle. Somebody else, it might be really high.
Depending on the sport as well.
Then we get to the attempts in the late 60s and early 70s to try and separate out cognitive and somatic anxiety. First time it was really attacked. And that's good. And the idea would be that cognitive anxiety is generally bad for you. The more anxiety you have in your mind, thinking negatively, the worse that is. So you expect a straight negative line, more is worse. And yet, we still say the inverted U for just physiological arousal.
So what you see is, there we go, there's a shape that we see. Two graphs overlapping, that's fine.
Big issue of how these two things interact. So what if I'm low cognitive, high somatic? What if I'm high somatic, low cognitive? What if I'm a bit middle on both? How does that interact? And realistically, the level of math that psychologists are able to do, which is mainly correlations, didn't allow us to answer that question very well. So we tended to just treat them as separate. Which is, questionable.
But that lasted a while. And it did allow us to identify different predictors or antecedents to each type of anxiety, a different temporal pattern. So there was a series of studies where they would look at how your cognitive anxiety would build up quite slowly and build up to an event, whereas your somatic anxiety would be fairly low and then peak right before you play, which makes sense. And it suggests that it's correct to separate them out, but it doesn't tell us how they're interacting or playing off each other. And as suggested, they should have different relationships with performance, which is this graph. So good,
it distinguishes between two types of anxiety, at last. Also good, when we do the questionnaire and look at them measuring different things, which is our main favourite way of saying it's good, it measures different, it predicts different stuff. It does that as well, good. Actually though, when you look through the studies, they were very inconsistent in what they were finding. And that's always a problem. Equivocal support is no support. And then, as I said, it's the interaction and the effect of each together and separately. And we're very bad at looking at how things interact in psychology because it's just mathematically very hard. Anything else I need to say? Oh yeah, the other thing I should mention is that it's still highly descriptive. It doesn't give us a mechanism. And any good theory only has to have two criteria, according to Karl Popper. It should make predictions that you can falsify. And if you can't do that, it's not a theory. And it should have an explanatory angle. It should explain what's going on and why. Not just describing things. If it's only descriptive and you can't falsify it, it's not a scientific theory. It's pseudoscience. Now, anything else I need to say on that? I think we've got it. The only other question, which is just for playing with, is cognitive anxiety always bad? Because if it was always bad, why do we do it? There must be situations that exist where we evolve this propensity to react. Something's gone wrong, switch on brain. And that, I think, makes a certain amount of sense. There are many situations in life where you just do what you're normally doing, or you do what feels right, without thinking about it, and it goes wrong, and then you've got this massive brain, the size of a quarter of a tennis court if you roll it flat, big piece of cortex on top of your head, which is devoted to thinking hard thoughts, analysing things. That's why we're here, that's why we're the most dominant creature on the planet, because we have that. So it makes a lot of sense. When it isn't working, think about it, solve it. The problem is, in sporting performance situations or in high performance situations, that's usually the worst possible response. Think about it in training, fix the problems there. When it comes to performing, just get on with it. Then we hit upon an attempt to solve the fact that there were two separate constructs, somatic and cognitive. Imagine, if you will, this is my very poor attempt to explain it, a flat piece of paper. And at one edge, you've got the inverted U. And then if I try and twist it, which might take me a while, so that the back edge is a straight line, and the front edge is still an inverted U. Very often I can create a kink, I've got too many sheets in here, but I can create a kink in the middle of the piece of paper, a little sort of cliff, a little fold. And that's really what this, I think, starts to look like. Because what we noticed was that some people, when they've had the Goldilocks moment and gone too far, couldn't get back. So if you imagine the inverted U and you work up and you go, oh, but a bit too anxious, I'll just go back. It should look like a little tiny adjustment. And yet actually, once someone's blown up, that's it, it's over, they're gone. So this theory tried to explain that by saying if you just topple over that cliff, you can't get back up. It was neat, it's an interesting idea. Really hard to measure in any way, shape or form without some really clever math. And again, relying on questionnaires. But it manages to combine the straight line with the curve. And I think the next slide, or the one after, it gives us a nice picture. Like that. Nope, like that. So like I suggested, so annoying. Basically, there's the cliff I'm talking about. So you can have your normal inverted view, you can overlay that with a straight line of relationship of cognitive anxiety, and you can see this effect where once you've tipped over, that's it. The only way out of that is to seriously calm down. Like go right to the other end of that model, right at the back, and then you might be able to clamber back up the curve. But just think about how you would measure that for a second. You've got to measure performance. That's really hard to measure. Cognitive anxiety, somatic anxiety, through a questionnaire, or should we find some other clever way of doing it? Really, really hard to measure. So it kind of It forces people into a situation where they're forced to say, I believe this is the truth. I believe this is a good theory. Which isn't good enough, that's not science.
And actually, looking at that again, the same problem occurs. It doesn't tell us why that happens or how that happens, it just describes the relationship.
There's no kind of causal chain from, well, if this happens at the same time as this happens, then it causes... I try to give the examples of how cognitive anxiety would be negative, because we know that we've got a limited bandwidth in our brain, and especially at the top level of our brain, we've only got a few things we can think about at a time, and if you have too many going through there, it gets clogged up, things get missed, and you make a mistake. And that's a kind of reasonably explanatory way of looking at it. And you could test that, you could falsify that. These theories just describe a relationship, that's it. The other thing I want to just add in, because if you look at the Lou Hardy video on the same week, he talks about one of the more interesting things in anxiety research is not so much the nature of the anxiety and measuring it, it's the fact that sometimes an elite performer would have been extremely nervous before a match. John McEnroe talks about this at great length. Sometimes he was in a really bad state before a match, and yet he would go out and perform really well. And he saw it as a wonderful sign that he cared and his body was alert and awake, and he interpreted the symptoms of anxiety as good, as being helpful. And yet somebody else feeling the exact same way, and for the sake of argument, with the exact same skills, who interpreted that anxiety as negative and unhelpful, could fall to pieces. And that's a fairly familiar story as well. So there's a really nice, in the reference list, I think I've put a reference to two papers that occurred in the same journal called Making the Butterflies Fly in Formation. And that was the beginning of our attempts to try and tease out why some athletes with the same symptoms and signs interpret them positively and thrive versus thinking it's a bad thing and failing. That's an interesting thing to try and dig around, especially for the sake of your critical blog. The other thing that I think is interesting is the transitioning from dry theory through to what a psychologist should actually do. This is one of the few things that actually is helpful for a psychologist. Is that there's a hypothesis that the type of anxiety should be matched to the type of solution that you propose, type of intervention. And I've used this hundreds of times with real clients. So if this person's experiencing cognitive anxiety where their head fills up with negative thoughts and too many thoughts and they can't concentrate, probably not that helpful to go, just breathe deeply, just calm down, just lie down flat, because you can still be thinking all those thoughts even though you're lying down and breathing. So the solution probably would be to stick with, okay, let's try and capture those thoughts and question them and work out why they're, whether they're appropriate and helpful, and if they're not helpful, what do we do about it? And to actually focus on the thoughts. And if someone's experiencing physical signs, heart rate, breathing, etc., then we intervene on the breathing, in the physical intervention. And that kind of makes sense. And I don't know how well it's been tested, but I can tell you that sat opposite an athlete, it works very well. They come back a couple of weeks later, and you normally find that you've made progress. That's one of the few that I've actually found genuinely interesting, as opposed to just telling an athlete, oh, well, this is what you're going through, which actually doesn't help them that much. Okay. And I must admit, in all of this, what we tend to miss out is the properties of the situation. We tend to overlook the fact that we're measuring something about the person, either their personality or evaluation of how they feel right now. Those are things that are really easy to measure with questionnaires. Again, there's a recurring theme here, right? If you look at the nature of the task, the difficulty of the task, the consequences of success and failure on that task, the time of day affects arousal, people's circadian rhythms, all these things you could factor into it if you wanted to. If you could have the desire to measure them all and build them into your model,
then you could end up with quite an elegant way of predicting how anxiety affects people. To date, we don't tend to do that. It's up to you to try and question whether you think that's appropriate, or whether it's maybe just borderline lazy on the behalf of our field. So at this point, we've got the progression of the models, we've got the fact that we can split them into cognitive versus somatic and state versus trait, which is vaguely useful, just in terms of conceptualizing. And then we go, ending up with that matching hypothesis. Okay, so what sorts of things can you do to try and overcome arousal? So I'm going to go through a few intervention techniques. It probably won't take long. As I say, the only bridge I'm aware of between diagnosing the type of anxiety or the experience of that person and then actually what to do about it, the only bridge I'm aware of is the matching hypothesis. All the theories that I just explained to you don't say, the person experiences this problem, here's what you do about it, which is a huge issue, but anyway. One of the favourites is to ask athletes or help them to become more self-aware. Because one of the biggest problems that people have, and I mentioned this at the end of the last lecture, is viewing their psychology as something which is out of their control. So you go, okay, well I feel bad now and that's out of my control, I can't do anything about it, woe is me, bad day. And it was, I remember vividly, this is going back a long time, but I remember the first time I was kind of made aware of this was when I was training up for a job in a call centre with like Amazon or Google or something, just answering the phones. But their training video was some people on a fish market who had a really thriving business, and they believed it was because every morning they would get to work and choose to be positive and happy with their customers. And I thought, well, that's interesting, it's a bit of a gimmicky video, but there's an idea in there that, and it's a genuine problem that people say this is something I can't control, it's just I've inherited it, or it's part of our culture. If you're able to become aware of the things that make you feel negative, what it's like to feel negative, perhaps the warning signs that you're about to get into a bad state, and you're aware of what to do about that, then you become empowered to change it. I said a few weeks ago that if you couldn't change any of these things, I wouldn't have a job, because I couldn't help you at all. I would just say, here's what's wrong with you, tough. Big issue. See, I have to believe it's changeable, and the evidence generally suggests that you can actually affect these things. Another sort of gimmicky phrase that I use, but I think it's really important to consider, is that as a psychologist, I'm trying to put myself out of a job. I'm trying to create someone who is their own best psychologist. Because realistically, they have access to all the best information. They can tell me how they feel, and I can guess whether they're accurate or truthful. But they experience all those feelings firsthand, and I can't ever experience that and know what it feels like. It's completely unique to them. So if they're in touch with those feelings and those emotions and those thoughts and how they play out, they're infinitely better placed to be their own psychologist. So I need to put myself out of a job, and this is what I'm talking about here. So, for example, typical situations, night before a game, suddenly can't sleep, what's happening? And again, if you go, woe is me, it's out of my control, then you're just going to have to suffer. But if you say, okay, what is going through my head? Why is that the case? What can I do about it? What would make me feel better? And then do those things on purpose, the chances are it can be resolved. On the way to the ground, in the dressing room, there are often certain things people do. I used to work in a team where people would, next to each other, there'd be a guy sat really quietly, just in his own little world, with his earphones in. And inches away, next to him, is a guy headbutting the wall, getting really, really worked up. And you're going, I can't believe that they're not affecting each other, that he's not saying calm down, or he's not saying, come on mate, psych up. But they were able to keep it separate, and you know, they'd had a lot of input and training in how to keep themselves separate. Usually, things like walking out onto the pitch, seeing the crowd, that sort of thing, can cause this reaction. And if you're aware of when it happens, before it even happens, you could be putting plans in place to deal with it before it happens. So an extreme example I've heard of is, you know, boxers who are aware of the fact that they get very nervous walking to the ring, trying to do things like have their earphones in. I heard of one guy who hypnotized himself, allegedly, to not take any of that information in. So that's the thinking behind it. If you know when it happens, then you can plan for it. You can also say, okay, well, do I have any habits where I know that I'm going to have a wobble? Are there any situations that always set me off? Oh, I spoke to someone a little while ago who said, I'm easily distracted. I know I'm easily distracted. What can I do about it? And, you know, potentially there are things you can do about that. So it's, again, make the athlete self-aware, empower them to notice it happening and deal with it before it's a problem. Realistically, as a psychologist, I can't follow you around going, okay, now think positively. Okay, now try and relax. It needs to be the person doing it for themselves. That's the key to this job. Again, if you're aware of the physical signs, which I've already mentioned at the start of the lecture, I think I got most of those, didn't I, apart from dry mouth, then you can see, especially if you're aware of the early ones, that's the key. And go, okay, well, I'm just starting to get anxious. These are the first couple of warning signs. And if I see them, I can actually do something about it. And again, that's a perfectly adaptive response. In an evolutionary sense, many of these things, evacuating the stomach, evacuating the other end of your body, increased heart rate, increased breathing rate, all of these things are adaptive responses. Big ugly monster jumps out, you need to run. All of those things are, or fight. You know, all of those things are adaptive in that respect, but in many situations where you have to deliver really precise skills under huge pressure, they're no longer a good response to have. And that's why it's a problem. So because we've changed the environment we live in and the way we perform, suddenly what worked for thousands of years no longer works. Towards the end of the planned semester, again, I might put it all online, we'll talk about some of the specific techniques around looking at your internal voice and your self-talk, trying to control the type of thoughts that you have and the frequency of thoughts that you have, trying to steer your emotions by using imagery and picturing things happening as you'd like. Setting goals that actually focus you on what's important and ignoring what's not important. And those would all be good tricks to use to overcome cognitive anxiety. They're cognitive tricks. When it comes to physical tricks to deal with physical somatic anxiety, there's only really two that leap to mind. Breathing control and progressive muscular relaxation. So, to talk through those very quickly. Breathing control has been tested a lot. There are multiple versions of it, and we're still not completely sure how effective it is. Partly because there's so many different ways of doing it. Infra 5, Alpha 10, Infra 2, Alpha 5, whatever it might be. Oh, I've missed out massage. Okay, so some people would say massage is a way of overcoming anxiety. It relies on having a good massage to hand, but okay. Muscular relaxation, in contrast, would be, it's something you can learn, but usually it's like a big script you get. If you need to go, that's fine. where you just go around your whole body, muscle by muscle, and deliberately relax it. And in some scripts, you have to tense it first, then relax it, and in some scripts, you just make a point of relaxing it. And the idea behind it is, you can practice that, and you can go from taking half an hour to do it, to 5 minutes, to 10 seconds. Once you've learned what it's like and how to do it. I think I've mentioned visualization. Orthodontic training was a weird one where you try and focus on a particular feeling and try and allow that to bleed over into how your body feels as well. What I'd like to finish with, assuming that
we match cognitive interventions to cognitive anxiety and somatic interventions to somatic anxiety. What I'd like to just end with for now is the evaluation of evidence, particularly on mainly physiological interventions around breathing control, muscular relaxation, and I'll try and do this for most of the lectures that involve a particular intervention. This one's focusing on physiological somatic interventions. Again, Della Moore, it was her PhD basically, and she's been the only person who's really attacked this, to look at whether these things work. And she focused on randomised controlled trials because that's the gold quality standard. So if we're going to use the same level of evidence as medicine does, where you have two groups who you've randomly selected, so there's no bias, and they don't know what's being done, whether they've got the intervention or the placebo. You have to have a placebo so that someone's getting a treatment that isn't the real thing, in case they know they aren't being helped and they react accordingly. People sometimes do that. So randomized controlled trials, and in particular we want sports athletes. We don't want something similar. So the bottom half of that screen, straight away, all undergraduates. Once again, the person's walked into the room, giving you guys a questionnaire to fill in, and then that's their research done for the year. If we go out and find reasonably good athletes and just focus on the top three and try and be good, so for example, that column, if they're a manual, what that means is, have you helped me to repeat your experiment by giving me what you did, the instruction manual? And if you haven't, it's a waste of time. I can't repeat your experiment, so it's not even science, it's just a story. If you have given me enough to repeat your experiment, and you've done it properly with randomization, what happened is, relaxation group was similar to the control group. Visual and motor breathing relaxation group was better than imagery, but that was the same as all the rest. We end up with really equivocal findings once again.
So I'm really asking you to push hard at that door of whether the evidence supports the claims that we make. Because you get the strong impression from YouTube videos, textbooks, overzealous psychologists saying, this works, this cures you, this makes you perform better as an athlete. And I would generally argue it could. I can understand how it works, and there's some evidence where it's worked and some where it hasn't. But I couldn't, with a good conscience, promise you it's going to work, and then you come back in a few weeks and say, psychology is nonsense. You promised me, and it hasn't worked. That's, I think, always going to be a huge open goal for you guys to work to, is how good is the evidence supporting the claim that we make in a particular area. And then, really interestingly, as a psychologist, this is my job, how do you ever give advice to someone when that's the best we've got? I think I'll leave you with that question, to be honest. Thank you very much for listening. I'll see you soon.